When we think about sort of a natural heritage, you know, you think about all of the interconnected animals and plants and bugs, it's important that we keep those systems intact, because that is really what allows us to continue to live. We need these natural systems in order for us to continue to live. We have developed most of the United States. It's, you know, all of our prairies are gone, you know, they turned into farm fields. Half of our forests are gone, we've cut them down. Cities are growing bigger and bigger. So we're putting more and more stress on these small, intact places. And we really are counting on them to kind of be our Noah's Ark to keep these species alive.
Located in northeastern Minnesota, along the United States and Canadian border, the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness is about 1.1 million acres of pristine wilderness that is now federally protected. With over 1,000 interconnected lakes, it is one of the most water-rich wilderness areas in the country, and there are no permanent residents except animals. The Boundary Waters was at one time protected by a natural barrier of wilderness. That barrier was broken by logging and mining. Advocates for wilderness preservation re-established a barrier of legal protection with several laws, including the 1978 Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness Act. This law restored the wilderness and has maintained a barrier of legal protection despite repeated attempts of breaking it. For thousands of years, the wilderness was largely intact. The Dakota, Ojibwe, and other indigenous nations had lived here, and in the 17th and 18th century, the fur trade came through. The Treaty of La Pointe in 1854 sold much of eastern Minnesota to the United States, opening it to further exploration and development. The mineral prospectors were the first to come and discovered iron ore on the Vermilion Range. Mines were developed in the late 1880s and early 1890s. Then logging companies came and began cutting down the forest. The natural barrier of wilderness was broken and under the threat of being totally demolished. The concept of wilderness preservation also came at the end of the 19th century because people had been exploiting so many resources that it was becoming clear that there wasn't an endless supply. There are three philosophies to wilderness. The wilderness preservationists, who want to keep it as is. Mixed-use people want some motorized use and development. And those who want to fully exploit the resources for development. This national movement, led by people like John Muir and groups like the Sierra Club, believed legal barriers of protection were needed to preserve wilderness areas. This is what Minnesotans fought in trying to preserve the Boundary Waters. A major victory for the movement unfolded in the 1920s and 1930s when preservationists convinced the Minnesota legislature and Congress to put legal barriers in place to stop a proposed series of dams in the middle of the Boundary Waters that would have raised lake levels by 80 feet.
And America took action. Congress and the legislature of Minnesota passed laws protecting the shoreline. The International Joint Commission denied the pending application for power development. The United States Forest Service enlarged the Superior National Forest and created a roadless area of over 1 million acres along the border below the Quetico.
Eventually, in 1964, the Boundary Waters became an official wilderness area when Congress created the National Wilderness Preservation System. While this officially made the Boundary Waters a federally protected wilderness, it didn't fully restore the barrier because it allowed logging and motorized travel. Many preservationists felt the legal barrier was incomplete.
The wilderness canoe country, so important to the health and happiness of thousands of people, is in jeopardy. Its wilderness character threatened.
The 1964 Wilderness Act that designated the Boundary Waters as wilderness carved out exceptions that were just for the Boundary Waters, and the exceptions allowed incompatible uses. They allowed logging and they allowed motorized use. And when the 78 Act addressed them, it made the management of the Boundary Waters consistent with and every bit as strong as other places in the country. And of all places, all wilderness areas, it really deserved that.
Defining that legal wilderness barrier took a lot of debate, a lot of political maneuvering, and a lot of time. These different ideas of what to do with the area led to different sides lobbying Congress and heating the controversy.
There are some people that want a wilderness solitude experience. They don't want to see anybody, nobody else. They don't want to see anybody. They want to be there by themselves. So I think they're very selfish in that respect.
In 1975, Minnesota Congressman James Oberstar introduced a bill to preserve part of the Boundary Waters as a motorless area and another part as a recreational and logging use. This inspired a group of people to form the Friends of the Boundary Waters Wilderness and oppose Oberstar's bill because they wanted the entire area protected. Congressman Don Fraser introduced a separate bill in 1976 that would make the entire area non-motorized and closed to development. Advocates like Friends of the Boundary Waters and Ely resident Becky Rum helped push for a compromise bill.
That's when I really, when I learned to go to Washington as a citizen and to walk the halls of Congress. I had maps and encouraged members of Congress, their staff, to have their bosses support the bill that became the 1978 Act.
That bill, known as the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness Act, passed Congress in 1978 and eliminated logging, snowmobiling, restricted mining, and allowed motorboats on only one-fourth of the water area. It was signed by President Jimmy Carter on October 21st, and the legal barrier of protection was created for the Boundary Waters. The Boundary Waters is not only important to me, it is important to many people of many cities, states, and countries. To the people of Ely and other towns along the edge of the Boundary Waters, it is a source of making money. Each year, the Boundary Waters contributes 18,000 jobs and generates over $850 million in tourism revenue. Whether or not the 1978 law ended the debate is also a disputed topic.
And so the law didn't really resolve anything. The people that didn't want it to be wilderness still didn't want it to be wilderness. The people who did want it to be wilderness still wanted it to be wilderness. So I don't think it settled anything. I don't think this is one of those things that just gets settled in a short period of time. I think it actually takes generations of people to get used to the new reality and finally accept it.
The 78 law restricted us locals from, I shouldn't say just locals, but they restricted people that wanted to do motorized use.
People like Becky Rum, who lives in the area, and her family, who have been there for generations, see this dispute as part of an ongoing cycle.
Policy change is incremental, and you move forward, and sometimes you fall back a little bit, and then you move forward and you fall back a little bit. And you do the best you can at the time. And so the 78 Act was the best we could do at the time to address the conflicts that existed. It didn't address all of them. It didn't address the conflict we talked about tonight, which was copper mining along the southern edge of the Boundary Waters. And so now we have to go through this again and resolve this conflict. And after we resolve this conflict, in probably 10 or 20 years, there'll be another issue that arises.
Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness Act from 1978 still stands today. While there have been flare-ups and disagreements over its implementation, most of the debate was unknown to many hundreds of thousands of people who visited the wilderness each year. That has changed once again. Many people are aware of it now because the natural barrier is threatened again, this time by mining. A Chilean mining company, known as Twin Metals, wants to mine copper and nickel from the southern edge of the Boundary Waters. Once again, people in Congress are debating what to do, and so are citizens across Minnesota.
Withdrawing part of the Superior National Forest from precious metals mining activity insults our way of life and disregards communities in the Northland.
For now, the legal barrier that protects the Boundary Waters is in place, but it's threatened once more. Will the legal barriers remain or be broken again?
And it is the most fantastic place on the planet as far as I'm concerned, because I can go up there and I can paddle into a place where I can drink water out of the lake. I can catch fish. I mean, I am the one guy who can't catch fish anywhere, but I can catch fish in the Boundary Waters and have just an experience that you can't have anywhere else. Be totally without anybody else around, no signs of civilization, and just have a chance to totally get back to nature.
A natural barrier of wilderness thousands of years old was broken in northeastern Minnesota by logging and mining. But advocates for wilderness preservation re-established a barrier of legal protection with numerous laws, including the 1978 Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness Act. This law restored the wilderness and has maintained a barrier of legal protection despite repeated attempts of breaking it.
A real strong feeling that I want my children and my grandchildren to experience what I experienced. I want you to experience it, Ronnie. And so the only way you can really do that is to be advocating for its preservation.